Hi. Now we can continue with the next talk. The topic is design and analysis of an efficient FPGA-based profiling tool to aid hardware or software partitioning for reconfigurable embedded system applications. For that, I request Manpreet Kaur to present the talk.
Thank you so much. So my topic, as she has already read, it's related to hardware-software partitioning for embedded systems. So what are the applications we see for embedded systems? Nowadays, they are everywhere. A simple clock timer, or maybe something more complex, like an airplane cockpit, or CCTV camera, or a smartphone everyone has, or a MRI scanner, or maybe some automotive vehicle. So as the complexity for the embedded systems is increasing, we need more and more systematic methodologies to go from the higher system level abstraction to the hardware level, which may be cycle accurate modeling, or maybe logic transistors, or maybe binaries. As per Y chart, it makes an assumption that each design, no matter how complex, can be modeled in three basic ways, which emphasize different properties of the same design. As you can see, there are three legs: behavior, structural, and physical. So behavior represents only the functioning. It might not indicate how to build the model, but it indicates a black box functioning. The set of components and connections are given by the netlist. And finally, they are put into a layout or PCB or some related hardware by adding dimensionality, that is the height and width of component, the position of component, routing, and all those things. And other are the concentric circles, showing the different abstraction level. We have a circuit level, which is actual implementation, might be some transistors or something like that. And then higher level abstraction is in terms of logic level, maybe some gates, AND gate, OR gate, or some other digital components. Then processor level comes any specific processor, custom processors for our application, or maybe some general purpose processors. And in system level comes your entire system, which might contain your processors, memories, or buses, your entire system. So as for different level of these different abstraction level, we need different people of different specialities. So the earlier the system design methodology used in 1960s was capture and simulate. The hardware, the software people used to design some algorithms, which is the functionality, and to the hardware people, that their job was to design the block diagram and put it into hardware and something like that. So between the specification and implementation, there is a huge gap. So verifications happened only after your implementation. So there was no verifiable document also in intermediate steps. So after 1980s, we had a describe and synthesize methodology, in which the software designers used to design their logic in terms of Boolean gates or FSMs, and the synthesis tools came into picture, which used to generate the netlist for that. And also the logic level got abstracted to a register transfer level and cycle accurate modeling, or those come into picture in the 1990s. After that till now, there is a more refined methodology, which is specify, explore, and refine, to close this hardware and software gap. So as an application engineer, I might know only C or C++. So I need to have different tools for different level of abstractions. And also I need that at every level, I might get some information about the performance of the system or something like that. Maybe communication characteristics or functionality. I need every stage to verify these things. So proper defined methodology was made, and each model at the higher abstraction level was an input to the lower abstraction level. So based on these, we have three types of majorly we have three types of designers in a system level design. First is the application engineer, who might use a specification model to prove their algo on a given platform. Generic platform. System designers, who you might use transaction level modeling to estimate the design metrics, how the communication is going on at the intermediate level. And after that, the actual implementation designers, who might use the cycle accurate model to confirm the correctness of the hardware versus software, or in case they are both in a same PCB. So we need implementation designers for that. So the benefit is that at every level you are you have specific tools to synthesize your system, so productivity increases, and even if there are globally distributed teams, at least you have an intermediate level of verification of at least some sort of property, functionality or area or performance, though not actually correct, because actually comes after binary or cycle accurate modeling, but an intermediate implementation for verification. So as the complexity of the design increases, we cannot put everything in software, or we cannot put everything in hardware based on the speed of deployment to the market, based on the speed of execution. So we need to decide what to put in software and what to put in hardware. For that, we might need to profile your system level application. Profiling in the sense you run your system level application through a profiler, which will tell you the performance characteristics, maybe how much delay is being taken, like it's C or C++, though in the loop or subroutine calling, how much delay is being taken. So that way you know what is the total delay taken by any software. So in case, for example, there are lots of multipliers, so maybe you might choose to put them in a hardware which is more efficient. There are different kinds of multiplier implementation or something like that. It's just an example. So you, after the profiling of the application, you divide the thing into software synthesis and hardware synthesis. Software synthesis will go into a processor, and the hardware will go into your hardware based on your libraries or maybe some reconfigurable logic. FPGA is targeted because it nowadays we have embedded FPGA embedded kits. They already have one processor in them in which you can put your C code, and apart from that we have a programmable logic, by which I mean it's just a matrix of some configurable logic blocks, to say in a layman language, which get configured based on your logic in your RTL implementation and hardware description language. So there are different kinds of profiling tools. One is software based, hardware based and FPGA based. Software based is like when I know that I have a loop, loop one from 1 to 100, I need to run this loop. So as a designer, I'll put something, some code in the starting, some code in the end of that loop. So it is actually instrumenting the code, so you're modifying your main code. For example, GNU GPROC, but we don't want an intrusive kind of profiler. Second is the hardware based, which there is some implementation changes in the processor done, which for example adding counters or something like that, which get triggered based on your event, maybe a function call or a loop detection, something like that. And they are FPGA based, which as I told you, they are you might run your C code in your processor inside the FPGA embedded kit, and you might have a reconfigurable logic where you can put your profiler. So it's like a generic to any C++ like system level application. You might not need to instrument your processor or your software code. So the generality of the profiling increases. So our target is that we should have a non-intrusive kind of FPGA based profiler. So there is one of the profilers, that is Snoopy. In case in this case, the boundaries of the starting of the function and, for example, the end of the function, they have to be known during the implementation of the profiler. And as many functions are there, as many counter segments you use. So so much information is required at the profiling end, and more the number of functions, more the number of counters, so more the number of hardware. Second is I guess that slide went after. Second is a leg up based profiler, leap profiler, in which you have it's only based for function, and it includes address hashing for all the functions. So there is an extra memory or extra algorithm required for address hashing. It also doesn't tell ki how many, one function has been executed how many times. This information is not there. You do only have the total count. So practically, where do we actually encounter loop and function calls? For example, this is a snapshot from taken from a convolutional neural networks paper. As you can see, there are around six for loops, and inside that there are three function calls. So we can have a C or C++ implementation as complex to this or more than complex to this. So getting the information of exact count of clock cycles for every function or for every loop requires a lot of tricks for profiler implementation, or that too making it general. So the cases that we are targeting is, first of all, simple individual loops we have. So we need to be sure when is the logic logic for loop one ending, and what is the logic for main code, and what is the logic for loop two. So we need to have exact counter. We cannot mix the loop implementation with the main code, or we cannot mix the two loop implementations. Second is, you can have an individual loop or you can have a nested loop. So you have to be sure that the logic for loop two is not added in the logic for loop one, or vice versa. You need to end your counting at that point. So proper triggering and speed is required in terms of hardware. Next is, if you have more than one nested loop, and similarly we can have individual or nested function, and the more complex one, if you have a function within a loop or a loop within a function. So you have to be sure at what address you need to stop your counting and assign it to a memory, and then restart your counting for the main code. And if, as you see, we have, you can have a path, a loop calling a function, then it calling a loop, or it calling a function. So we might also need a path based profiler in which it will accumulate the total count of that path. So in case possible, through parallelism, we can put that entire path in a separate hardware. So for example, this is a C code. So you can see that for we are using only a PC address from the processor inside the FPGA. So the initial two are for initializing the count, and the rest is the back branching loop. So the condition that we are detecting is the last address, B2B, BC, B2, FFDC, which is backward branching. So in case you subtract, it has to go to 1CC address. So in case you decode this FFDC, 1CC, 1F0 minus 1CC is 24 hexadecimal. So in case you decode this FFDC, which is in a two complements form, you can you will get 24 hexadecimal, which is equal to 36 in decimal. So in this way, such kinds of instructions which we directly get from the microblaze, in which we do not require tagging or something, we are using this information without any intermediate node in or logic in between. So present work which has been done based on this logic is that we can have a total count of an individual loop or a total accumulated count for a nested logic loop. But we do not have the actual data regarding what is happening inside a nested loop. Maybe it is calling some separate subroutine. Maybe the loop to logic is very, very complex or takes a lot of time. So we need to differentiate from the loop one logic. So this this kind of dimensionality is not there in the existing profiler. So my idea of a loop profiler is that I'll have a first is the instruction decoder, which will decode the instructions, like I told you, B2, BC, B2, FFDC. So it will decode the instructions so that it can detect, okay, it's a loop, now I should start counting. And the second is the clock cycle counter, as soon as you detect a condition. Third is the how many loops have been detected. Maybe like a loop is being called 5 times or 10 times based on that. So I have a separate counter for how many times a loop has been detected, separate counter for how many cycles are there in a single loop. And we have a content addressable memory in which we will store the PC addresses for comparison of how many times that loop or function has been called. Then we have the storage. For storage of these counts, we have an individual loop counter, an accumulated loop counter, and a loop occurrence tracker. This is a very important thing because you need to exactly know when is the loop exiting and when is the another loop starting, so that you do not mix the counts. So this is a very important circuit inside a loop profiler which is detecting nested loop counts or subroutine counts. So for example, this is a loop occurrence tracker. So as soon as I detect the first loop, it will be marked one. As soon as I get into that, so means it's a nested loop. So it will get more into one. So and it will go on like this until whatever is the depth of the loop. And as the return instructions start, then it will be going back. So it will help us coordinate the way the loops are exiting. I mean, this is just my idea. I mean, I've implemented the individual modules. Right now, I have to just make the supporting circuitry based on, I have to interface all these things, and I'm right now trying to test my content addressable memory in actual hardware. So this is the flow that I am adopting. I have using a Xilinx embedded development kit. I have an integrated system environment software in which I can put my profiler logic, and it will generate binaries and netlist based on that, which will be exported to a Xilinx platform studio, which contains, based on my information, it will add microblaze to it and other profiling logic or whatever software logic I require around that microblaze, which is the Xilinx processor. And then is the software development kit. You actually need to have a platform to put your C code into that processor. So this is done using a software development kit, and each of these steps generates the logic of the netlist and binaries. And also in the Xilinx platform studio, I need to insert a ChipScope as a peripheral. ChipScope is like a logic analyzer in which you can see the waveforms of what is happening. So to test it in hardware, you burn your code in FPGA and you can test it in ChipScope. So after that, I analyze my logic in ChipScope based on proper triggering conditions. So this is how a platform is created. You have a microblaze, and from microblaze you get four information. First is the PC, the program counter value. Second is the valid, whether the instruction is valid or not, whether jump is taken or not, and whether your what is your opcode. So it is given to loop profiler, and everything is in communication through the bus system specific to that Xilinx FPGA. So earlier I chose to use the Xilinx inbuilt IP core CAM, but it was giving issues with the nested loop implementation, because from a CAM you need to know whether there is some program counter, some input data matching or not, at which address it is matching. But in a nested loop implementation, it was not properly updating the output match and output match address. So I had to make my own CAM. So I made a comparison logic and then separate match address logic for that. So the input data, which will be of the program counter, will come into the CAM, and then we have a CAM enable and CAM reset signal based on the external FSM in the main loop code and the clock coming from the main code. And then we have an output match address, whether there is a match already in CAM or not. In case not, it will throw out where it has written the data. And this is an internal signal, and write enable, whether you have to write your CAM or not, based on whether the information is already existing or not. So based on this, I have simulated the results in software. I'm doing it on hardware. So based on this, as you can see, I've implemented a nested loop of def2. So it starts at this 200 program counter, and then we have a nested loop at 208, and the nested loop implementation ends here at 234, and then the main code implementation ends here at 225C. So based on that, I have the match address values. So initially the CAM doesn't have any match, so it will write the first address at the zeroth location. And after that, as soon as it detects intermediate nested loop, so it will write the location of that nested loop in the first CAM location. And this is, as you can see, it's 25C, it is detecting this one. First it goes into main code, and then it jumps back to the internal code. This is the way assembly code is written normally. So these are the FSM states from my main logic profiler going from 1 to 7 based on my logic. And these are the references.
Real-time issues don't figure at all in this development, because embedded systems, real-time issues are...
So we can have different, we can have real time constraints and embedded systems and all those. So, as of now, our task is to design a profiler. It is taking directly information from the processor directly. There is no interface in between. So it depends on how fast you want, what is the maximum speed of the processor. So as of now, it's running at the maximum speed of the processor also, of the inbuilt processor.
This is something original, is it, that you have done?
So the previous thing which I told you, till now the latest thing is you have an accumulated count for the nested loop or functioning, and you have individual counts for the individual loops. But we don't have the information for the nested loop, inside loops or functions. So this thing has not been done, so I'm trying to do that.
Okay.
what type of benefits do you expect from your profiling tool compared to what others have? So
others, first of all, either they are only for function, either they are only for loop. We are designing for, we'll design a single profiler for both loop, function, and path-based things. As of now, I'm targeting loop as an initialization. Any other problems, I'll get afterwards maybe.
Are you able to quantify your results and say that your profiling tool is so much better compared to the earlier one? Is it possible to say?
Yeah, so based on the previous papers submissions, we can.
Have you done any exercise of that type?
I have till now only put my my cam in nested loop implementation, but till now that supporting logic of the profiler to interface all these things, it is yet in, still in progress. So after that, once it's done, I'll get the individual counts. The individual modules I have built, the supporting logic is left.
At the end of the work, do you expect to have some hardware functioning?
So we are targeting FPGAs, which are now actually being used in implementations also by different companies. So we are targeting the Xilinx FPGA that we already have. And in hardware, I'm checking in ChipScope, which is a logic analyzer. So I burn my bitstream and verify it in ChipScope.
It's yet to be done.
No, for the for the this implementation, it is yet to be done.
It's extending what you identify something like a state of art because when you start your evaluation, you have to compare your results with something which is state of the art. So you've already identified.
So I have the like previous loop implementations or function implementation counts in the previous research paper. So based on those, I'll first compare my count. And it can also be compared from the assembly code visible to the designer. So based on that, I can compare whether it's counting correct or not.
Maybe there are one question. You have to compile the code, no? But if you're starting on the C code, can you not do any profiling? Why is it done? Why you have to do it, go all the way to compile code?
C code you can simply also compile in a embedded FPGA, but my aim is that I need a profiler also along. So I need to create my platform which includes my profiler as well as the processor. And after that I can put my C code in the processor and generate this ELF format.
Higher level profiler
okay.
And the C level, you can't do that?
So that is a software based profiler, so and again it will be intrusive, it won't be generic to the applications. Like as a system designer or a C code based designer, I don't want to add statements at the start of the loop and the end of the code and modify my code. I just want to put my code as it is in the profiler. So that's why it's a non intrusive.